Yes, RJ, good evening. Good evening, Jayashree. Good evening, Kiruba. Good evening, Uvasri. Good evening, Rituparna. Good evening, Kiruba. Okay. Yes, somebody please ping me if I am audible so that I can start the session. Yes, guys, somebody please ping me if I'm audible. Good evening, Amiya. Yes, guys, somebody please ping me. Okay, thank you. Good evening, Kamal. Hello everyone, welcome to Unacademy, India's largest online learning platform. Let's crack UPSC CSE English. Now before I begin with the topic of Home Rule League movement, let me introduce myself for the students who are new on the platform. My name is Alok Ojha. I have done my engineering from Pune. I have been associated with the field of UPSC since past 6 to 6.5 years. I have been through various stages of civil services exam. I hold the experience of giving serious SSB twice. I also hold the experience of exams like CAPF Assistant Commandant and Uttar Pradesh PSC. I am involved into the field of teaching since past 4 to 4.5 years and I have mentored more than 10,000 students for UPSC. Now, before I start with the topic, let me introduce the platform in short. Now, there might be a question in the mind of an aspirant why one should prefer Unacademy as a platform for online learning. So here are the ample of reasons why one should prefer Unacademy as a platform for online learning. First of all, you'll have daily live classes on the Unacademy platform. Unacademy offers you assimilation of top and dynamic educators of India on a single platform. You can directly interact with the educators. You can clear all sorts of doubts with the educators. Second most important aspect is developing competence or competitiveness. Now, why competence or competitiveness is important? Because each year, approximately around 8 to 9 lakh forms are being filled up for UPSC, out of which 3 to 4 lakh aspirants appear for the prelims exam. 10 to 11,000 qualify the prelims exam, 3 to 4,000 qualify the mains exam, and finally, 800 to 1,000 odd make into the final list. So if we summarize it, one aspirant is competing with 800 to 900 other aspirants. And in that case, he needs to build up that sort of competence or competitiveness. And Unacademy helps up to build up your competence by going through live tests and quizzes. All the courses on Unacademy platform are highly structured in nature and there is a proper timetable through which the courses are being conducted. And one can have unlimited access to the courses on Unacademy platform. These are the few top and dynamic educators of India from whom you're going to learn through. These are the courses being offered on the Unacademy platform. Subscribe to Unacademy and use my code AKOUS. I repeat the code AKOUS. Now there is also called as something iconic subscription. Now what is iconic subscription all about? Let us understand within few seconds. For example, if you are a beginner and your preparation is highly directionless because you do not know what strategy should be used, what timetable should be chalked down, then how much time should be dedicated to a particular GS paper, how much time should be dedicated to a newspaper reading, what are the sources of current affairs, what is the importance of government magazine, how an optional subject should be selected, what is the importance of answer writing. So all your work would be simplified by a personal mentor. This mentor would be guiding you throughout your journey for civil services preparation. And he would be guiding you basically on various aspects of this exam. So if you choose me as your mentor, please use my code AKOUS. I repeat the code AKOUS. Now, good evening, Prince. Good evening, Satya. Good evening, Kajal. Good evening, Shashank. Good evening, Apurva. Yes, guys. Am I properly audible? Yes, please let me know. Am I audible properly? Is there any need to increase the sound or the volume? Yes, guys, please let me know. Okay, thank you. Now let's get started with a very dynamic topic today again, that is Home Rule League movement. Now let us understand the basics of Home Rule League movement. And before that, as usual, I do a small background for the students who are attending my session for the first time, or a small background basically of yesterday's session. Please pay proper attention. Okay. Everything should be clear in the class itself. At home, just you have to revise. Getting the points clear, you just have to revise back. Otherwise, each and every thing should be clear in the class itself. Okay, my friends? So let's get quickly started. After revolt of 1857, there was replacement of company's rule in India by the rule of crown in India. And now finally, on 28th December 1885, there was a formation of an organization which was called as Indian National Congress. And one of the major efforts was taken by a retired British civil servant whose name was Alan Octavian Hume. The first session of the Indian National Congress was held at Bombay, and the first session was presided by Vomesh Chandra Banerjee. It was attended by 72 delegates from nook and corner of the country. Second session of the Indian National Congress was attended by 436 delegates, and it was presided by Grand Old Man of India, Dadabhai Nauroji. It was held at Calcutta. And in the second session of the Indian National Congress, it was decided that basically every year we are going to meet at a particular place and discuss the issues of national importance. Third session of the Indian National Congress was held at Madras and was presided by first minority president of the Indian National Congress, and it was Badruddin Tayabji. Now it is said that by 1900, the number of delegates increased to 2000. Right from the start itself, Congress was divided on the basis of ideology. And there were two ideologies that were existent in the Congress. One was moderates and the other was extremists. As the name itself suggests, moderates believed in gradual progress. They believed in steady progress. They believed that we do not want independence all of a sudden. We want independence in a stage by stage manner, because they did not have the confidence in themselves to govern their own country. Now, extremists were exactly opposed to this. They believed that it is our nation and we are ready to govern ourselves. We do not want independence in a stage by stage or gradual manner. We want immediate independence, and that too Swarajya. Swarajya means complete independence, not just self-government. So there were ideological differences right from the start itself. In 1905, Lord Curzon announced the partition of Bengal. And what reason did he cite for partition of Bengal? He cited basically one of the major reasons was Bengal has become too big to be administered, and Bengal cannot be governed by a single governor general. That is why we want to divide the Bengal into two parts, that is West Bengal and the East Bengal. But what was the actual hidden intention behind that? East Bengal had a Muslim majority area and West Bengal had a Hindu majority area. And basically, the people in this region were living in a very cordial manner with each other. There was no communal violence in this region, and Britishers wanted to break the communal harmony of Bengal. They wanted to divide the Hindu-Muslim unity. That is why they decided to partition the Bengal. And against the partition of Bengal, a movement was started in India, specifically in Bengal. And that movement is called as Swadeshi movement. Now, what is Swadeshi? Swadeshi means we are going to use the goods which are produced in our own country. Now, initially it was decided that basically the call for Swadeshi movement was given by Gopal Krishna Gokhale in 1905 session of International Congress, which was held at a place called as Banaras. Now, the movement became very famous in the region of Bengal. Now, extremists wanted the movement to spread to other parts of the country. Why? Since the movement was successful in Bengal, this can be replicated in other parts of the country as well. So, but moderates wanted the movement to be confined just to the region of Bengal. So, for the first time, there was a strife between moderates and extremists. Secondly, in 1906, basically it is said that extremists wanted Lala Lajpat Rai or Bal Gangadhar Tilak ji to be the president of Indian National Congress. But moderates proposed the name of Dadabhai Nauroji. And Dadabhai Nauroji was a very respected and a revered personality. Although he was a moderate, but he was respected by moderates and extremists both. So, moderates proposed the name of Dadabhai Nauroji. And finally, Dadabhai Nauroji presided over 1906 session. In 1907 session, it is said that there was differences between moderates and extremists. And the session was held at Surat. Initially, it was decided that Lala Lajpat Rai would be the president. But later on, Raj Bihari Ghosh, a moderate leader, became the president at the Indian National President of Indian National Congress, which was held in Surat in 1907. And here there was huge differences. There was a scuttle. There was a fight between moderates and extremists both. And after this, there was division of Congress into two parts. That is moderates and the extremists. And both of them parted the way. Now, it is said that majority of the extremist leader like Aurobindo Ghosh, he retired from active politics. Bipin Chandra Pal, he temporarily retired from the politics. Lala Lajpat Rai ji, he went to England. Then Bal Gangadhar Tilak was sent to 6 years imprisonment at a place called as Mandalay in Burma. Okay? This is till yesterday. Yes, my friends, did you understand the background so that I can start the session now? From a fresh start. Yes, guys, please let me know any question, any query. Yes, Prince, just like as Atmanirbhar. Good evening, Supriya. Good evening, Monisha. Okay. So now let's get started with Home Rule League movement. Now, name, please read the etymology Home Rule. Now, Home Rule basically means rule of self. Okay? We are Indians and we have the authority to govern ourselves. We do not want any alien rule to govern over us. We do not want any alien rule to dictate terms and conditions over the people of India. So we want our own administrative policy. We want our own administration. That is home rule. That is rule of self. Now, basically, the idea emerged from Annie Besant. And Annie Besant was basically an Irish lady. She was born in London. But there was an organization. There was a socio-religious organization whose name was Theosophical Society. Pay attention properly. Theosophical Society was formed in New York and it was formed by Colonel Olcott and Madame Blavatsky. Colonel Olcott was an American colonel and Madame Blavatsky was a Russian lady. Both of them formed an organization that is called as Theosophical Society. And the most important objective of the Theosophical Society was to promote brotherhood and fraternity. Like, each and every European country at that time was practicing colonialism. And what is colonialism? In very simple words, colonialism is nothing but imperialism plus exploitation. In very simple language, conquering new and new territories, acquiring new and new places, and exploiting the people and the resources of that places. This is nothing but colonialism. So one of the objective of colonialism was basically to promote brotherhood of man. Everyone belongs to a same race, and that race is human race first. And one of our most important religions should be humanity and mankind beyond every religion. So this was the purpose of Theosophical Society. Now, after the death of Colonel Olcott, Theosophical Society came in India. And Theosophical Society established its headquarters in India at a place called as Adayar in Madras. Now, in India, Annie Besant was made as the head of Theosophical Society. Initially, Theosophical Society was involved just in the activities of which were decided in its objective. But later on, it was involved in all sorts of societal reforms in India. Now it is said that Annie Besant was proponent of Fabianism. Now what is Fabianism? Fabianism is equivalent to socialism. Things would be controlled by the government, but people would be independent. Like basically, there would be economic development in the form of modern industries. These industries would be controlled by the government, but it is not necessary that management would be controlled by the government. There would be proper elections, there would be proper lawmaking bodies, there would be proper, what we say, execution of the policy, there would be proper interpretation of the law. In very simple words, Fabian socialism has the reflection of principles of democracy. So Annie Besant was a proponent of Fabianism, and Home Rule League movement in India was brought by Annie Besant. And the idea was inspired from Irish Home Rule League movement. Now, what is Irish Home Rule League movement? Let us understand in few words. Now, basically it is said that at that time, Ireland was a part of England. It was a part of UK. And Ireland, although it was associated with UK, UK was dictating terms and conditions to Ireland. Now, Ireland said that we want our own self-government. We won't detach ourselves from Britain, but at least we should have the right and the authority to frame our own policies, to choose our own dignitaries. So initially, a movement was started around 1870s in Ireland. And one of the pioneers of this movement was Isaac Butt. I repeat, Isaac Butt. He started Home Government Association. Later, it was given the form of Home Rule League movement in Ireland. And from this movement was inspired Home Rule League movement in India. Okay? Now it is said that there were two leagues in India. One league was founded by Annie Besant, and the other league was founded by Bal Gangadhar Tilakji. Because as I have told you, in 1908, Bal Gangadhar Tilak was arrested and he was imprisoned in Mandalay jail. And he was imprisoned for 6 years continuously. And finally, he was released in 1914. So he decided basically to start a movement in India. Okay. Now, what were the factors that led to establishment of home rule movement in India? Now, let us understand this. Pay attention properly. Congress was just a deliberative body by now. Now, pay attention properly. Now, extremists had their own working pattern. Moderates had their own working pattern. But still, they worked for the nation. But once after the Surat split, when they were divided into two parts, there was complete political vacuum in India. There was hardly any political activity in India. You can say that for 6 years, we were slaves. There was hardly any movement that was nurtured in India. And people had accepted slavery as a part of their life. They have accepted it as a part of their fate. Now, people have completely lost the self-confidence. And basically, it is said that previously, Congress was just a deliberative body. Now, what is deliberative body? For every minor issue, rather than directly talking with the Britishers, they are negotiating terms and conditions with the Britishers. Rather than negotiating, they can go for asking more and more rights. They can ask for self-government. They can ask for Swaraj or complete autonomy. But basically in the initial years, Congress was just a deliberative body. Then Morley Minto reforms, which came in 1909, was purely dissatisfactory to Indian. Now pay attention properly for the people who are new on the platform. Now pay attention properly. As per Morley Minto reforms, listen to me very carefully. As per Morley Minto reforms, number of members in the Provincial Legislative Council and Imperial Legislative Council were increased. Initially, if we see, as per Indian Council Act 1892, number of members in the Imperial Legislative Council were 16. But as per Morley Minto reform, the number of members were increased to 60. Now pay attention properly. What will the aspirant feel that more number of ministers are enrolled here? But actually this was not the case. It is projected that 60 ministers are appointed, 60 seats are given in the Imperial Legislative Council, but it was actually just 11 seat. How? Listen properly. Out of 60, 33 were nominated and 27 were elected. And among the 33 nominated seat, these were majorly nominated by big zamindar, industrialist, moneylenders, landlords, British colonialist, and so on. And out of 27 elected seat, 8 were reserved for Muslim, 6 for zamindar, and 2 for British capitalist. So it comes down to how many seat? 16 seat. How many seats are left? Just 11 seat. So elections would be held only for 11 seat. So in such a systematic manner, Britishers are trying to fool us. They are projecting that we are associating more number of Indians in the administration. But this was not the fact. They are showing that we are giving more powers to Indian. But actually, the powers were not given to the Indians. Getting the points? Indian ministers, members in the Imperial Legislative Council and Provincial Legislative Council had the right to discuss the budget. They were a part of debate and discussion. But they cannot vote upon the budget. So if they can discuss the budget, but if they cannot vote upon the budget, what is the use of such debate and discussion? Isn't that so? For example, if Britishers want to spend more amount of money on buying weapons, now Indian ministers feel that rather than spending money on buying weapons, Britishers should work basically for welfare activities in India. They should promote education. They should develop infrastructure in India. They should establish modern industries in India so that poverty could be alleviated. Employment opportunities could be generated. Our ministers want this. But what happened here? It was Governor General who would decide whether to implement it or not. So we can discuss the budget, but we cannot vote upon it. So what is the use of such debate and discussion? Hardly it is worthless. Getting the points? So in very simple words, it seemed that we were given more powers, but actually we were not given any powers. Okay? Now, a certain section of nationalists now believe that we need a movement to be started again. We need to develop a political fervor and political pressure on the Britishers so that we can gain more concessions from the Britishers. Because for past 6 years, there have been complete state of inactivity. There is a complete vacuum in India. Okay? And now, in World War I, basically it is said that from 1914 to 1919, World War I was fought. Okay? Indirectly, India was a participant in the World War I because Britain was fighting in the name of colonialism. It was expanding its territories in a very rampant manner. And indirectly, Indian Army was associated in the colonialism. The resources were driven out of India. Pay attention properly. Resources were driven out of India. Okay? There were large-scale unemployment in India. Our budget was facing deficit because more money was spent on buying weapons. More money was spent on buying arms and ammunition. So Britishers could not develop infrastructure in India. Getting the points, my friend? So basically, there was shortage of food in India. because all the food was diverted in Britain for the soldiers who were fighting war in the World War I basically. So there was food shortage in India. Inflation was rampant. The prices of essential commodities was very high. And people were overburdened with taxation. People were overburdened with rising taxes and so on. And again, World War I, it projected the racial superiority. Now, for example, Britain is acquiring more and more colonies. Now, it is not going to develop these colonies. Why it is acquiring more and more colonies? Because it wants to increase its profit margin. Now, basically, it is going to exploit the people and the resources of that region. That is why Britain was acquiring more and more colonies. They were subjugating the people of new colonies. So again, after revolt of 1857, in the World War I, it was again projected racial superiority. There was a sort of racial discrimination. Now, Tilak was, as I've told you, in 1908, Tilak was imprisonment. And in 1914, Tilak was released. Now, Tilak believed that there is a need to start a movement now again in India. Because people were already facing various problems and people have lost the self-confidence. Now, we need to regenerate that self-confidence. We need to revive the movement so that nationalist fervor is developed in our country. And now, basically, both Annie Besant and Tilak felt that until and unless both the wings of Congress are united, that is, moderates and extremists are united, we cannot basically think of a movement on a pan-India basis. Because there are various leaders of moderates from different parts of the country. There are various leaders of extremists from different parts of the country. And they have a hold over their region. They can sensitize the masses. They can sensitize the people in their region. And that is why it is necessary that moderates and extremists forget their differences that were occurred previously. And now they should come on a common platform again to work against the common enemy. So now, initially by 1915, Annie Besant started a movement she started a campaign for self-government in India. And basically, she started a campaign through her newspaper Commonweal and New India. My friends, I have discussed these newspapers in the press, if you remember. So basically, it is said that Commonweal and New India, the newspaper of Annie Besant, played a very major role in sensitizing the masses. But now Annie Besant wanted the support of a Congress to spread the movement on pan-India basis, to take the movement to the nook and corner of the country. Now in 1915, Annie Besant approached the Congress. Pay attention properly. In 1915, to garner the support of the Congress, she approached the Congress. Okay? And she asked the Congress that basically extremists should be readmitted into the Congress so that we can start a national movement in India. And the 1915 session was presided by S.P. Sinha. And she asked a permission from S.P. Sinha that she wanted to start a movement in India. And for that, she requires the support of Congress. But S.P. Sinha did not give any support. He said that right now we cannot give you any support from the side of Congress. Okay? And the most important reason behind that was by now two major leaders of the moderates, that is Gopal Krishna Gokhale and Firoz Shah Mehta, had died. And Firoz Shah Mehta, like Gopal Krishna Gokhale, he was one of the most mature politicians of moderates. If you remember yesterday's Surat split session, I have told you when there was differences between extremist and moderate, Gopal Krishna Gokhale was trying for a reconciliation. So there shouldn't be any breakup of the Congress party. Okay, he was such a mature politician. But by now, because of his death, there was a political inactivity in the Congress. Lion of Bombay, Firoz Shah Mehta, has also died by now. So S.P. Sinha said that basically, we cannot support you. But yes, you can start your own educative propaganda. Like you can use your newspaper, that is Commonweal and New India. And through these newspaper, you can sensitize the people of India. You can sensitize the masses. You can carry on your propaganda. But, and she said also one thing, but if Congress is not supporting in this propaganda, I will start my independent movement. Finally, Tilak started his Home Rule League in April 1916 and Annie Besant started her Home Rule League in September 1916. Now, both of them started their two leagues separately. They could have started basically together. But the main reason for starting the two leagues separately was basically Tilak has his own working pattern and Annie Besant has her own working pattern. Both of them are going to coordinate with each other, undoubtedly. But to avoid any friction in the working pattern, okay, Tilak started his own league and Annie Besant started her own league. My friends, did you understand the introduction of Home Rule League? Please let me know. Good evening, Pulli. Good evening, Ram Kumar. Yes, Kamal. In the end, I'm going to take a separate lecture on all the sessions of Indian National Congress. Don't worry about that, Kamal. Yes, perfect, Satya. See, Apurva, basically it is said that Annie Besant approached Tilak for that and Tilak supported her basically that yes, you can go for starting a movement. Okay, but Tilak said that basically we will be covering different parts of India so that you start your own league and I would be starting my own league. And since I am an extremist leader, Congress, it is very difficult to what we say convince Congress initially. Okay, hope so I have answered your question, Apurva. Okay, now let's start with the two different leagues. Now, Tilak started his own Home Rule League movement and Annie Besant started her own Home Rule League movement. But objectives to an extent were same, working pattern and the activities to an extent were same. Now, Tilak's Home Rule League movement was called as Indian Home Rule League. And Tilak started his league from a place called as Belgaum. Now, Belgaum is located on the borders of India. It is located on the borders of Karnataka and Maharashtra. So, Tilak started or announced his Home Rule League from this place. And headquarters was Pune. And the national headquarters was at Delhi. Now, Muhammad Ali Jinnah also supported the activities of Bal Gangadhar Tilak. I have told you, Muhammad Ali Jinnah is also referred as Muslim Gokhale. And initially, he was supporter of Bal Gangadhar Tilak. He supported the policies of Bal Gangadhar Tilak and he was a disciple and follower of Bal Gangadhar Tilak. Okay. Now, League had 6 branches, some of them in Maharashtra, Karnataka, Berar and central provinces. And now, League had majorly 3 demands. One was Swarajya. Now, pay attention properly. Now, here the definition of Swarajya is quite different from the previous definition of Swarajya. Initially, what did Bal Gangadhar Tilakji said? Swarajya is my birthright and I will have it. And Swaraj basically for me means complete independence, complete detachment from the Britishers. But now, Swaraj for Tilak means self-government. We will be associated with the Britishers, but basically, we will be having our own dignitaries. We will be having the rights and authorities to frame our own policies and run our own administration. So Swaraj now is self-government. Second was formation of linguistic states. Now, please do not get a different connotation that if the states are formed on the linguistic basis, it will promote regionalism. No. Now, there is a different meaning for that. Now, why formation of states on linguistic basis? I'll give you a very simple example. Now, in the region of Bengal, people speak Bengali. In the region of Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, people usually speak Bhojpuri and Avdi. In the region of Punjab, people speak Punjabi. In Haryana, people speak Haryanvi. In South India, for example, in Tamil Nadu, people speak Tamil. Andhra, they speak Telugu. Now, what will happen here? The leaders are quite close to the people at the grassroots level. And if a local leader is heading a particular movement, what will happen? It is quite easier to sensitize the masses. Yes, there would be a central leadership, but there should be more local leaders because they are, what we say, in contact with the people at grassroots level. And when they are in contact with the people at grassroots level, it is quite easier to sensitize the masses. Because why? People will feel that the leader has been chosen from within us. So that is why there should be formation of states on linguistic basis. Education should be given in vernacular. Now, why education should be given in vernacular? Pay attention properly. Directly imposing English education in India would lead to administrative inefficiency. Okay, English was a language which was new to Indians at that time. Very few Indians were educated in Western languages. They were educated in Western thought. Now, basically, one of the major purpose was to introduce education in vernacular, basically means education in local language or mother tongue, so that people can easily understand the concept. Okay, like at least the primary and the secondary education should be in vernacular language so that the fundamentals of education are deep rooted. Concepts are very clear and higher education can be in English language, but initially the education should be in vernacular. These were the demand of Tilak's League. Now, Annie Besant's League was called as Home Rule League. Pay attention, Tilak's League was called as Indian Home Rule League. And Annie Besant's League was called as Home Rule League. Now, basically it is said that it was set up in September 1916 at a place called as Madras. And right from, as I've told you about Theosophical Society, when Theosophical Society arrived in India, it had its headquarters at a place called as Adayar near Madras. And Annie Besant was the head of the league. Annie Besant was the head of the society in Madras. Now, Annie Besant had a contact with a person named as George Arundale. Now, George Arundale, basically, he was secretary of Annie Besant's League. And he carried on activities in different parts of India. Annie Besant League had 200 branches in India. Getting the points clear? Tilak's League had 6 branches. Annie Besant's League had 200 branches. And the headquarters was in Madras. Okay? It was very loosely organized in comparison to Tilak's League. Now, why it was loosely organized in comparison to Tilak's League? Is it possible? Is it easier to manage 6 branches? Or is it easier to manage 200 branches? Obviously, the administrative efficiency would be better in 6 branches. Isn't that so? Because there would be coordination between different leaders. But Annie Besant's League was loosely coordinated, and the major reason behind that was basically, it had many branches. Getting the points clear? These are the other members of All India Home Rule League. Pay attention properly. Indian Home Rule League means Home Rule Movement of Tilak. Home Rule League means Home Rule League Movement of Annie Besant. And All India Home Rule League means movement of both of them. So these are the various leaders like Motilal Nehru, G.S. Kharpade, Bhulabhai Desai, Lala Lajpat Rai and so on. These are associated with either the League of Tilak or with the League of Annie Besant. Yes guys, did you understand this? Please let me know. See Satya, basically sovereignty, it can be said that even sovereignty of India was now even intact. Why? What does sovereignty means? Although we are associated with some or the other country, but we are free to choose our own dignitaries. We are free to make our own policies and law-making bodies. Getting the points clear? So initially it was complete detachment from British rule, but now it is just self-government. Hope so, Satya, I have answered your question. Yes, please. Yes, no domination surfaz. Now let us understand the objectives of Home Rule League movement. See, yes, Prince, do you want me to explain the similarities and differences? Yes, Prince, please let me know. Do you want me to explain again the similarities and the differences? I'll again explain within short, within a minute. Now, pay attention. Tilak's Home Rule League was called as Indian Home Rule League. And Besant's Home Rule League was called as Home Rule League. Tilak established the league at Belgaon, but the headquarters was at Pune. Besant's League was established with the headquarters at Madras. Besant's League was established in September 1916. Tilak's League was established in April 1916. Tilak's League had 6 branches and Besant's League had 200 branches. Tilak's League was very good, in a very efficient manner it was organized, and Besant's League was loosely organized. Hope so the differences are clear. Yes, please. Yes, Prince. Yes, perfect, Satya. Tilak's League and Besant's League compiled together to form All India Home Rule League. Hope so the points are clear. Yes, Komal, I have repeated the concept. Did you understand? Prince, yes. Did you understand the concept that I have repeated? Okay, thank you. Now, objective of the Home Rule League movement. Now, let us understand. Either it be the League of Annie Besant or it be the League of Tilak. Objective was lump sum similar. Now, both of them had the objective of self-government on the lines of colonies like Australia and New Zealand. Now, what is self-government? I have already talked about this. I'll explain that again. Self-government means we will have our own sovereignty. We will have the right and authority to choose our own dignitaries, frame our own policies, and choose our own basically elected representative. But we would be attached to Britain. That is self-government. Okay? One of the other way was to develop an agitation. One of the other objective was to develop agitation in the country. The reason behind that, as I've told you, from 1908 to 1914, there was complete political vacuum in India. There was state of political inactivity in India. Why? Because in Congress, only moderates were left. All the extremist leaders were either arrested or imprisoned. And many of the extremist leaders retired from the active politics. So there was a state of inactivity in the country for a span of 6 years. And that is why it is necessary to politically educate. And for that, discussions and debates are necessary. Okay. Now, in 1908, during the Swadeshi movement, Britishers came down heavily on our nationalists. They suppressed the movement in a very brutal manner. Many of, like, as I've told you, students participated in the movement. And when students participated in the Swadeshi movement, what happened? Scholarship of the students were cancelled. Many students were beaten up heavily and brutally in the police lockup. Then many students were expelled from the schools and colleges basically. Then basically, many of the nationalists were arrested or imprisoned. So in very simple words, I mean to say that Britishers in a very brutal manner suppressed the Swadeshi movement. And that is why people had lost the confidence. People had lost the nationalist zeal and fervor. And again, to break this stagnation, Home Rule League movement was started. To break this stagnancy, this movement was started again. To revive the movement. Getting the points clear? To revive the political activity. Now, one can believe, I have told you one thing, differences between moderates and extremists. What did moderates believe? We want progress in India. We want independence, but not all together. We want in a stage by stage manner. They also believed in constitutional agitation. In very simple words, we are going for prayer, petition, and peaceful protest. But that will not be beyond the constitutional limit. It will be within the constitutional framework. So they believed in the policy of what? Constitutional agitation. And similar was the objective of Home Rule League. And what was that objective? We are going for protest. We are going for sensitizing the masses. We will conduct tours. We will conduct speeches. But it will be within constitutional limit. In simple words, within samvedanik daira. Got the points clear? Then, greater political representation from the British government. Now, as I've told you about the Morley Minto reform, actually it was projected that the seats in the Imperial Legislative Council had been increased to 60. But we had discussed it earlier. It was hardly 11 seats in if we see it properly. So more number of Indians should be associated in the administration. So this was the objective of the Home Rule League movement. Now pay attention, what were the activities of the league? And there has been a question in the UPSC prelims exam about the activities of the league. So listen properly. Now, first of all, as I've told you, people had lost complete confidence. Because after Swadeshi movement, majority of the leaders were either imprisonment or took retirement from the active polity. And now one of the aim was to convey the common man the message of home rule. First of all, to develop the lost self-confidence among the people. As I have told you previously, many a times Gujarati speaking areas or Gujarati speaking districts of Bombay presidencies were not the part of Swadeshi movement. If you remember it, guys, they were not the part of Swadeshi movement. We have discussed this in detail. Now, basically, it is said that League attracted the people from the backward regions of Gujarat and Sindh. Now, it is said that in Sindh, Hindus were in minority. And many Hindus were also participant in the movement and the activities of the Home Rule League. So, basically, it is said that the movements that have been taken place, like initially we have learnt about Revolt of 1857. Revolt of 1857 was largely confined to the northern part of India. Swadeshi movement, it was confined majorly to Bengal, Bombay and Pune, then Punjab, Delhi and Madras presidency. It did not went to Sindh and Gujarat, but now the region of Sindh and Gujarat were also covered. And what did League do to, what we say, sensitize the masses? Discussion, public meeting, libraries, lecture tour. Now there was library being opened up. And these libraries had many books. And these books were completely on the basis of ideas of socialism and democracy. So that people can learn Western ideas and thoughts. And when they will learn Western ideas and thoughts, they would be surcharged with the zeal. They would be again surcharged with the enthusiasm and full of ideas of liberty, equality and fraternity. That is why library, a very important word. Pay attention properly. You can see the papers past year, previous year question papers. You will see a question basically and 70 to 80% of the student have given the wrong answer. One of the statement was, consider the following about Home Rule League movement activities. And one of the statement was, library was used as a medium to generate nationalist fervor. So basically, students marked this as wrong. But library was used as a basis for developing nationalist fervor. Getting the points clear? Then, newspaper, pamphlets, posters, placards, basically plays, religious songs were organized to sensitize the masses. And the League not only sensitized the masses about the movement, it also got involved in the social work activities. Like it also got involved in societal reforms. Like basically there was land revenue system. Okay. Like many farmers were basically many zamindars were exploiting the farmer. So League also campaigned against the zamindar. They also campaigned against the European planters. They also campaigned against the land revenue policies that were implemented by the Britishers in India. And as I have told you previously, although Tilak had his own league, Annie Besant had her own league, but both of them cooperated with each other. I have told you the reason that to avoid any friction in the working pattern. Because if we observe it properly, if we read it properly, Annie Besant to an extent, I'm not saying completely, Annie Besant to an extent had an ideology of the moderate. Why? How come we come to know that she had an ideology of moderates? Because she believed in constitutional agitation. So this simply reflects that Annie Besant had an ideology of moderates. and Tilak had his own working pattern. So to avoid any friction in the working activities, they opened different leagues, but still they cooperated with each other. Okay? They not only cooperated, both the leagues not only cooperated with each other, they cooperated with Congress and the Muslim League as well. Getting the points clear? As I've told you previously, until and unless Congress is united, it is not possible to run a movement on pan-India basis. It is not possible to run a movement at all India level. Got the points clear? Now, what was basically, and what was one of the activities said that basically, people felt that India's resources were not used for development of India. And we have discussed this in Drain of Wealth. Now, for the people who are attending my session for the first time, I have covered a session on economic exploitation by the Britishers. And in that session, I have explained about drain of wealth theory. In that, I have basically talked about how India's resources were in a very systematic manner driven out of India. And this was highlighted for the first time by Dadabhai Nauroji in his book, Poverty and Un-British Rule in India. So maximum number of resources were driven out of India. I'll give you a very simple example. For example, if Britishers want to invest some money anywhere, the money will go from India. If any civil servant is appointed, salary is given from Indian Treasury. A pension to civil servant is given from Indian Treasury. If Britishers have taken loan anywhere, the interest on that loan would go from Indian Treasury. In very simple words, these are called as home charges. In very simple words, the resources, the money, the capital of India is not used for welfare of Indian. It is used for increasing the profit margin of the Britishers. So basically, in very simple words, one of the objective of the Home Rule League movement was to sensitize the people about this again. What happened here? What was government attitudes toward home rule? Government came down with severe repression. Okay. Now, especially for the students, basically in Madras presidency, students who were participants in the Home Rule League movement, they were either arrested, their scholarship was cancelled, they were beaten up in the police lockup. Now, I have told you in Swadeshi movement, if you remember it properly, moderates wanted Swadeshi movement to be confined to Bengal. But extremists wanted Swadeshi movement to, what we say, spread to different parts of the country. So Bal Gangadhar Tilak started Swadeshi movement in Bombay presidency. Now Swadeshi movement was not famous in United Province, that is in the region of Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. Bal Gangadhar Tilak ji went to Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, United Province. He sensitized the people there. And he created a zeal and enthusiasm among the youth of United Province. Okay. So now, this would be done again by Tilak ji in Home Rule League movement. That is why Tilak was not allowed to enter in Punjab and Delhi. Now in Punjab, there was a very good friend of Bal Gangadhar Tilak. That is Punjab Kesari or Sher-e-Punjab. That is Lala Lajpat Rai. And 100% Lala Lajpat Rai ji is going to support Bal Gangadhar Tilak. That is why Tilak was not allowed to enter the region of Punjab. Okay? Then Annie Besant, B.P. Wadia, George Arundel, all these are associated with the League of Annie Besant. They were arrested and imprisoned. Then S. Subramanyam Iyer, he was associated again with the League of Annie Besant. He renounced his knighthood. Okay? Now, did you understand till here, my friends? Please let me know. Did you understand till here? No, Komal, this class did not start at 6 p.m. The class started at 7 p.m. Yes, Satya. Perfect. Yes, guys, did you understand till here? Okay, Now let's get started with the significance of the Home Rule League movement. Now, Swadeshi movement was confined to Bengal. Moderates, now it is criticized that moderates initially confined their activities to the elite section of the society. They confined their activities to the elite class. But extremists tried to create a link with the masses because they believed that the potential that masses have can gain independence for India. And if the masses are united under their leader, they can create havoc against the alien rule. So extremists initially showed that kind of trust in the masses. Getting the points clear? Now what happened? Home Rule League movement, I have told you initially that Gujarat initially was not majorly a part of the movements that was taking place in India. But Home Rule League movement spread to new areas, like it spread to Gujarat, it spread to Sindh region, because in the Sindh region, Hindus were in minority. Kashmiri Pandit in Kayas and Kashmiri Pandit in United Provinces, that is in the region of Kashmir and United Provinces, were also participants in the movement of Home Rule League. So basically, initially those who weren't surcharged, those who were not the participant of the movement in earlier phases, were now the participants in the movement in Home Rule League movement. Okay? Now, this movement created a sort of a link between the cities and the town and the villages. As I've told you that Basant's League had more than 200 branches. And there were many people, there were many leaders who were associated with Bal Gangadhar Tilak ji and Basant's League. So they went to nook and corner of the country and sensitized the masses there. So it created a generation of new and ardent nationalists. What is ardent? Kattar nationalist. Now they were ready to sacrifice anything for the cause of nation. So Home Rule League movement created a generation of ardent nationalists. And it prepared the masses for Gandhian style of politics. We'll understand when we'll study about Gandhi. Okay? Now, Montagu Chelmsford Reforms or Government of India Act 1919 was influenced by the activities of Home Rule League movement. As we have seen, Morley Minto Reforms of 1909 or Indian Council Act of 1909 was influenced by Swadeshi movement. Similarly, Home Rule League movement created such a fervor in the country that basically Britishers were hell-bent to create new set of reforms in India. And this resulted in the form of Montagu Chelmsford Reform or Government of India Act 1919. Why it is called as Montagu Chelmsford? Because Montagu was Secretary of State for India and Chelmsford was Viceroy of India. Another significance of Home Rule League movement was when Tilak was released from the jail in 1914 and he discussed the issue with Annie Besant, both of them felt the need that until and unless both the wings of the Congress are united, they cannot fight against the common enemy. So, one of the major significance was the extremists and the moderates, both of them had parted away in Surat session of 1907. Now they again came back in the Congress in 1916 at Lucknow session of Indian National Congress. So, due to the activities of Home Rule League, there was merger of extremists and moderates in Indian National Congress at Lucknow. Okay, then movement organized the Congress Party. As I've told you, basically from 1908 to 1914, there was complete political vacuum. There was a sort of political inactivity. People had lost the confidence. People had accepted slavery as their part of life. They have accepted this as their fate. Majority of the leaders had retired from the politics. So in very short, there was a sort of political vacuum in the country. And Home Rule League movement filled up that vacuum in later part. It again generated self-confidence. It again generated enthusiasm and zeal in the people. So this, it revived the lost confidence of the Indians basically. Okay, now let us understand what were the reasons for failure of Home Rule League movement. Now pay attention properly. First thing, There was outbreak of communal riots to an extent. We have seen about Mopla Rebellion, which occurred in 1920. Okay. Now, Mopla Rebellion, although it occurred in 1920, but its genesis had been started from 1915 and so on. Now, what is Mopla Rebellion all about basically? Now, there was one system called as Zamindari system. Under Zamindari system, Britishers are going to collect the tax or lagan from Zamindar. In very simple words, Britishers are not going to collect the tax or lagan from the peasant. Britishers are going to appoint a Zamindar. And this Zamindar, on behalf of Britishers, is going to collect the tax. Okay? Now, what happened in the region of Kerala? The peasant, that is the farmer, majorly were Muslim. And the Zamindar were Hindus. So, there was a initiation. Finally, there was a revolt in 1921. But there was initiation of communal riots to an extent in these place. Initially, it was a Zamindar and a peasant fight. But it was given a communal color. Okay? Now, why did it fail again? Now, Muslims did not participate in the Home Rule League movement to an extent. Why? Because Muslims felt that, like the Congress, like it was an basically a sort of a different, what we say, Muslims did not had that trust. Because Muslims felt that, like the Congress, again the Home Rule League movement would be dominated by the Hindus. That is why many Muslims kept themselves aloof from the activities of Home Rule League. Okay, now what happened? Similarly, like Swadeshi movement, I have told you one aspect. Okay, Britishers always followed two policies in India: divide and rule and carrot and stick policy. Divide and rule to break the communal harmony of the country, and carrot and stick means, for example, if Britishers have to suppress one section of the Indian society, what will it do? It will pacify the other section of the society. Okay, for example, if we have to suppress our enemy, okay, and if we are basically, if we are not that strong in comparison to our enemy, what we'll do? We will befriend someone else. Similarly, to suppress one section, Britishers pacified the other section. Okay, so Britishers, like Swadeshi movement, what happened in Swadeshi movement? When extremists were running the movement in entire India, moderates were coordinating. Moderates were discussing or negotiating with the Britishers in London. Okay, which resulted in the form of Morley Minto reforms. Similar thing happened here. Now, there was a person named as Valentine Chirol. He was a British journalist. And he said, and he criticized the policies of Tilak. And criticized Tilak as father of Indian unrest. And he was also a author of a book called as Indian Unrest. And he said that whatever unrest, civil unrest is going in India, it is just because of Tilakji. And Tilakji became very angry on this. And he filed a case against Valentine Chirol and went to London to fight this case. And when he went to London, there was a loss of leadership base in India. And when he went to London to fight the case, Britishers saw this as an opportunity. What did they do? They negotiated with Annie Besant. And they told Annie Besant that we are going to introduce reforms in India. And now, they introduced fresh reforms in India, which resulted or culminated in the form of Montagu Chelmsford reform. Getting the points clear? When Tilak was fighting a case in London, Britishers were negotiating with Annie Besant here. And overnight, Annie Besant became a loyalist to the Britishers and she started negotiating with the Britishers on Montagu Chelmsford reforms. Getting the points clear? Now it is said that after the First World War was over, M.K. Gandhi became the president of Home Rule League. And later on, this Home Rule League movement was merged with the Indian National Congress. And M.K. Gandhi named Home Rule League as Swaraj Sabha. Please remember this important fact. When M.K. Gandhi got associated with Home Rule League, he named it as Swaraj Sabha. Okay? Now, Home Rule League proposed the idea of what? They proposed the idea. Tilak proposed the idea of passive resistance. Then, Home Rule League initially it although generated the concept of patriotism. Like I have told you initially that Annie Besant to an extent was a moderate. I have used the word, my friends, to an extent, not completely. She was a moderate. Getting the points clear? But this does not mean that she completely adopted the policy of moderates. Like it is said that moderates believed in prayer, they believed in resolution, they believed in petitions. This was not followed by the Home Rule League. So they abandoned the policy of political mendicancy, asking reforms for continuously from the Britishers. Okay? By now, Annie Besant was arrested under Defense of India Act. And now, mass protests began all over India. And American President Wilson intervened for her release. And then she was released. And there was discussion with Montego and Chelmsford, which resulted in the culmination of Montego-Chelmsford reform. And as I've told you, my friend, when M.K. Gandhi became the part of this movement, Home Rule League movement, okay, he named the Home Rule League movement as Swaraj Sabha. So please remember this. Yes, my friends, did you understand the entire Home Rule League movement? Yes, please let me know. Yes, guys, did you understand the entire movement? Any question, any doubt, any sort of query? Lakshmi, it will take almost around half an hour more for the session to get completed. Okay. Okay, now let's get started with Lucknow merger. As I've told you, the efforts were basically taken by whom? The efforts were taken by Tilak and Annie Besant. When both of them were starting the Home Rule League movement in India, it is believed that Tilak and Annie Besant both believed that until and unless the extremist and the moderate section of the Congress are united against a common enemy, it is not possible to run a movement on pan-India basis. That is why it was decided to forget the previous differences. So, at Lucknow session of Indian National Congress, which was presided by Ambika Charan Muzumdar, there was basically reunion of extremists and moderates. It was completely after 9 years. Like extremists and moderates had parted their ways in 1907 session of the Surat, which was held on the banks of River Tapti. Now they were reunited at a place called as Lucknow. And basically, it is said that this session was presided by Ambika Charan Muzumdar. Now, what were the factors that led to reunion? Old controversies had become meaningless now. Like moderates had their own working pattern. Extremists had their own working pattern. Moderates had their own different ideology. And extremists had their own different ideology. But the goal and the intention was common. They had the similar goal, they had the similar intention. Moderates wanted gradual independence in India, and extremists wanted all of a sudden independence, immediate independence in India. But what was the final goal? Independence of India. Getting the points clear? So old controversies by now had become meaningless. Now both moderates and extremists have realized that if basically we are fighting, if we are bickering with each other, we will make the work of Britishers easier because Britishers are ready to take undue advantage of any particular situation. Because Britishers are ready to tackle the policy of divide and rule. They are ready to play the game of divide and rule. How? If moderates or extremists are fighting with each other, this will make the work of Britishers easier. And this we have seen for past 6 years, from 1908 to 1914, complete loss of self-confidence among the people, complete loss of nationalist zeal among the people, loss of nationalist fervor in India. So both of them realized this. Tilak and Annie Besant both have campaigned for a reunion. Then, basically, both of them supported reforms. Tilak had said that, like basically, Tilak was an extremist leader. Okay. And Tilak had a very different style of working pattern. And Tilak said that, basically Tilak felt that until and unless both of them are reunited, we won't be able to make much progress in that case. So what needs to be done basically here? We need to fight basically unitedly against the common enemy. And Tilak said that all the decision would be taken on the basis of majority. Like it will not happen like the Surat split. Extremists are having their own views, moderates are having their own views. It will not happen in this manner now. So Tilak promised that he will denounce all the acts of violence. And one of the major reason for merger was basically Congress did not had major leaders now. Because two major leaders, I have told this, I have discussed this earlier. Firoz Shah Mehta, that is Lion of Bombay, and Gopal Krishna Gokhale ji had died by now. And this facilitated the reunion. And this is nothing but Lucknow merger in the history of modern India. Yes, my friends, did you understand the Lucknow merger? Yes, Britishers, like everyone got into the trap of the Britishers, Satya. Okay, like Britishers, like they suppressed one section, they pacified the other section. Got the points clear? So, see, Jayashree, although she had moderate thinking, but there were certain followers because although, as I've said, both Besant and Tilak were associated with each other league, they coordinated with each other's league. So what happened? To an extent, there could have been spurt of violence that, like we have seen, there were what we say outbreak of certain communal revolts, communal riots, basically. So what happened? That is why Annie Besant was arrested here. Hope so, Jayashree, I have answered your question. Yes, Jayashree, please let me know. Okay, now let's start with another important aspect, Lucknow Pact. It also occurred in 1916. It occurred in Indian National Congress session of Lucknow, which was presided by Ambika Charan Mozumdar. Okay, now let us understand about the Lucknow Pact in short. Now, right from the start, I'll give you a small background so that people who are new on the platform or attending my session for the first time, they can easily understand the concept. Okay, now, right from the start, Sir Syed Ahmad Khan was loyal towards the Britishers. Now, during the revolt of 1857 as well, he was loyal towards the Britishers, and for his loyalty, he was given knighthood basically. He was given the title of Sir. Now, it is said that he believed that if we remain loyal to the Britishers, basically, some or the other day, Britishers are going to repay for our loyalty. Now, in fact, Syed Ahmad Khan, when there was formation of Indian National Congress in 1885, Syed Ahmad Khan asked his Muslim delegates, asked his Muslim associates not to be the part of Congress and to detach themselves from the activities of the Congress. Although he did not found a separate organization against the Congress, but still he was not the part of the Congress right from the start itself because he believed that we are going to support the Britishers. We are going to remain loyal to the Britishers. And if we are loyal to the Britishers, what will happen? Britishers will repay back us for our loyalty. Now, in 1905, Lord Curzon announced the partition of Bengal. Now, this partition of Bengal was opposed by 90% of Hindus and Muslims. But there was certain section of the Muslim who supported the partition of Bengal. And there was a reason behind that support. And what was that reason? Lord Curzon, who had announced the partition of Bengal, had poisoned the minds of certain Muslim. Now, what did he said basically to certain section of the Muslim? That if you support the partition of Bengal, what will happen? I will create a university in East Bengal. That is Dhaka University, which will lead to educational upliftment of the Muslim. I will create a port in East Bengal, that is Chittagong port, and this will lead to economic upliftment of the Muslim. This was promised by Lord Curzon to certain sections of the Muslim. And finally, in 1906, All India Muslim League was formed by Nawab Salimullah of Dhaka and Aga Khan. And the headquarters of All India Muslim League was at Lucknow. Initially, they maintained loyalty with the Britishers. But in 1911, there was annulment of partition of Bengal. Partition of Bengal was cancelled. And to an extent, a section of the Muslim League which was loyal to the Britishers, now basically, they were completely shattered by the policies and they believed that we have maintained loyalty towards the Britishers for so many years and what did we get? Now, they were again angered by one more incident. And what was that incident? There was World War I. Now, in World War I, basically, Turkey was on the opposite side of Britain. Now, Turkey was ruled by Caliph. And Caliph was the head of all the Sunni Muslims in the world. Now, whatever Caliph said, all the Sunni Muslims throughout the world. Now, Britain defeated Turkey in the World War I. And it started imposing all harsh terms and conditions on Turkey. Now, what happened basically? The position of Caliph was replaced. Caliph was overthrown. Many, what we say, mosques, many dargahs were destroyed in the region of Turkey. This hurted the sentiments of Muslims all over the world. And specifically, the Muslims in India. And there was a section of the Muslim League, which was called as Young Party. Now, Young Party believed that, what did we get by maintaining loyalty towards the British government for so many years? Now, they decided basically that, we are going to work with the Congress and put forward our demand in front of the Britishers. Now, after the end of World War I, or when World War I was nearing the end, Britishers offered a bit of fresh reforms in India, which was in the form of Montagu-Chelmsford reform. And they asked every section of the Indian society, basically, to discuss the reforms and be the part of the reforms. Okay, so that we can create a constructive reforms in India. Now, Muslim League decided to work with the Congress. And the reason behind that was, it will project Hindu-Muslim unity. And Britishers will now not play the game of divide and rule. Now, they will believe that Hindus and Muslims are united together. There is a communal harmony in the nation. And that is why, basically, at this juncture, both of them decided to work together against the common enemy, that is Britishers. But before Congress started working with the Muslim League, there was a pact being signed. And this pact is referred as Lucknow Pact. Did you get the background of Lucknow Pact, my friends? Please let me know. Yes, Dipesh, perfect. Yes, Satya, Dipesh, true. Yes, guys, did you understood the background here? Okay, thank you. Now let us understand the important clauses of the Lucknow Pact. All these clauses are important from exam perspective. Time and again, there have been questions on the clauses of the Lucknow Pact. Okay. Now let us understand the clauses. I'll discuss each and every clause. Listen to me properly and carefully and patiently. All your doubts would be clear. Okay, let's get started. Muslim and Congress both jointly demanded self-government in India. Now, what happened in the revolt of 1857? What was the major, one of the major causes for failure of revolt of 1857 was, everyone was fighting for their own cause. Very few section, or we can say that nobody was fighting for a common cause. Here we have to project a common demand, that is independence or self-government. So both of them decided, that is Muslim League and the Congress decided, that we are going to portray a common demand, that is self-government. Then Muslims demanded that, it was signed in the pact that Muslims should be given 1/3 representation in the central government. I'll give you a very small example. Now, basically, for example, if there are 60 to 70 seats, out of that, 30 seats should be reserved for the Muslim, 20 seats should be reserved for the Muslim. In very simple words, it includes even the cabinet. Getting the points clear? So 1/3 seats should be reserved for the Muslim in the central government, or Muslims should be given representation there. As per Morley Minto reforms of 1909, the Muslims were given a separate, what we say, electorate. Muslims were, seats were reserved for the Muslim as per Morley Minto reforms 1909. Now it is said that the seats should be reserved for other minorities as well, until and unless that community, until and unless that minority demand a joint electorate, a separate electorate should be provided to all the minority, like Sikh, European, Anglo-Indian, Parsis, and so on. Getting the points clear? A separate electorate should be provided to the other communities as well. This was one of the demand. Then, minority political representation should be given everywhere. Getting the points clear? Like, as I've told you, 1/3 representation should be given in the... Are the points clear? Number of members in the Imperial Legislative Council should be increased to 150. Pay attention properly. As per Indian Council Act 1892, the minimum number of members in the Imperial Legislative Council were 10 and maximum were 16. As per Morley Minto reforms, it was increased to 60 members, 6-0. Now, there was a common demand to increase the number of members to 150. So from 60, the number of members should be increased to 150. Okay. As we have seen, as per Morley Minto reforms, there were 60, what we say, seats in the Imperial Legislative Council. Out of 60 seats, 33 were nominated and 27 were elected. Pay attention properly. 33 were nominated and 27 were elected. Out of 27, 6 for big landlords and zamindar, and 2 for basically Britishers. Basically, how many seats are left? 11. How many seats are projected? 60 seats. How many seats are elections are held actually for? How many seats? Just 11 seats. So what is the common demand here now? The demand is election should be held for 4/5 seat. In simple words, in simple language, election should be held for 80% of the seat and nomination for 20% of the seat. In very simple words, if there are 100 seats, 20 seats should be filled by nomination and there should be election compulsorily for 80 seat. So 4/5 should be elected and 1/5 should be nominated. Now for major provinces like Bombay, Madras and Calcutta, the number of members should be increased to 125. Okay, like they had 50 member initially. As per Indian Council Act 1892, Bombay, Calcutta and Madras had 20 member. As per Morley Minto reforms, the number of member were increased to 50. Now it was demanded that in the majority provinces, in the majority presidencies, the number of members should be increased to 125. And in minor provinces, it should be 50 to 75. Okay. It should be, election should be on the basis of adult franchisee. And what is adult franchisee? It should be like a particular age limit should be there to be, to elect the, basically, the ministers. Getting the points clear? It should be completely on the basis of adult franchisee. Okay. Then, I'll give you a very simple concept. No bill concerning a community, please pay proper attention, because in this clause you will also find one more flaw. So please pay proper attention to this clause. No bill concerning a community should be passed if the bill is opposed by 3/4 members of that community in the Legislative Council. Pay proper attention. Now, there is a flaw in this. For example, there are 100 members in Imperial Legislative Council. And if a bill is proposed for a particular community, suppose a Muslim community. Okay? Now, this bill will not, now basically what should be the criteria? If the member, that is 75% of the member of the Imperial Legislative Council, if they have given the green signal to the bill should be passed. It should be the entire Imperial Legislative Council and not a particular community. Isn't that so? The bill, like for example, if a bill is to be introduced for a particular community, entire parliament makes a law or a particular community makes a law? Entire parliament makes a law. Isn't that so? Similarly, the rule should be similar here. Here, entire Imperial Legislative Council should make the law. But what clause was there? If 75% of that community members are ready for that bill, then and then that bill can be introduced. Otherwise, it will not be passed. Getting the points clear? Although suppose there are 100 members in Imperial Legislative Council. Out of 100 members, what should be the criteria? 70 or 75 members should give a red-green signal to the bill. Then it will get passed. But what has been the clause here? Suppose there are 100 members. And out of 100 members, 30 members belong to a particular community, minority community. Now, 3/4 of 30 should give a green signal. Then the bill will pass. This is one of the major flaws of this clause. The act should be passed by the entire body, not by a particular community. Getting the points clear? Then, term of Legislative Council should be 5 years, minimum 5 years. Okay? Then Legislative Council should elect the what we say their president among themselves. In very simple words, who elects the speaker? Yes? Please let me know. In our present context, who elects the speaker? Yes, guys, please let me know. Yes. Yes, the elected member of parliament among themselves elect the speaker. Similarly, here, the president of the Legislative Council should not be appointed. Getting the points clear? It should not be appointed by the Britishers. He should be appointed by whom? By the members of the Legislative Council themselves. Then, half of the members, minimum half of the member should be Indian. Then Viceroy have an executive council. Like Viceroy will not perform his duty alone. Viceroy will have somebody to assist him in performance of his duties. Isn't that so? So basically, the people or the Viceroy's executive council should have more number of Indian. There should be separation of executive from the judiciary. And the reason behind that, If the power is concentrated in one hand, it will lead to misuse of such power. We have heard about a phrase, power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Okay? So these are the important clauses of the Lucknow Pact. And basically, it talks about majorly Hindu-Muslim unity. Yes, my friends, did you understand this Lucknow Pact? Please let me know. Yes, Dipesh. Bengal Chamber of Commerce and universities, basically, these were industrialists. It consisted majorly of industrialists. And these industrialists were majorly loyal towards the Britishers and their policy. So, Britishers wanted the people in the Legislative Council who would be loyal to them. But what did Indians should feel that? That the ministers are nominated by the Indian themselves. That is why in British Chamber of Commerce, these industries were allowed to nominate the members in the council. Hope so, Dipesh, I have answered your question. Okay. Now, why was League ready to work with the Congress? As I've told you, Britain was against Turkey in the World War I. And it imposed very harsh terms and conditions on the Turkey, even in the Balkan and Italian wars. These wars are also like the policy of imperialism and colonialism. We are going to discuss this in the world history. Okay, so basically, British refused to help the Turkey there. Then, as I've told you, Muslims were initially promised that if you support the partition of Bengal, there would be a creation of university in Dhaka. There would be creation of a port in Chittagong, which will lead to economic upliftment of the Muslim. But there was annulment, there was cancellation of the partition of Bengal in 1911, which annoyed certain section of the Muslim. And I have told you, there was one section of the Muslims in the Muslim League, which were heavily dissatisfied with the policies of the Britishers. And they believed that, what did we get by maintaining loyalty towards the Britishers? Getting the points clear? So basically, this was called as a young party. I have mentioned that in the end. Okay. Now, newspapers like Al Hilal of Maulana Azad, Comrade newspaper of Muhammad Ali. Okay. Now, they sensitized the Muslim masses about working with the Congress and maintaining Hindu-Muslim unity against the common alien enemy, that is the Britishers, basically. So that is why League decided to work with the Congress. And many leaders of the League initially, who were opposed to the working with Congress, now were working with Congress, basically. Getting the points clear? Now, let's quickly understand the impact of the Lucknow Pact. Now, initially, Muslim had a fear that Congress would be dominated by the Hindus and they would be side-cornered. What happened? What was a positive consequence of the Lucknow Pact? This fear, to an extent, was segregated now. Now, there was a separate electorate for the Muslim. There was proper representation being given to the Muslim. All the decisions were taken in consultation with the Muslim League. So now, this fear was completely allayed. Okay? Now, there was large-scale enthusiasm throughout the country. Why? Because at Lucknow session, there was merger of the two important wings of the Congress, that is moderates and the extremists. Then, Muslim League and Congress both have decided to work together. Getting the points clear? And because of this, government was under pressure to introduce new reforms in India. Because of the effect of Home Rule League movement, because of the Lucknow merger, because of the Lucknow Pact, government was under pressure. And under this pressure, they were ready to grant, basically, government was declaring that in a stage-by-stage manner, not all together, not all of a sudden, in a stage-by-stage manner, they are going to introduce self-government in India. This was a positive impact of the Lucknow movement. And what was the negative impact? Listen to me very carefully. One clause, I have explained the negative impact, if you remember, about the religion clause. Okay? That if any law is to be made, it should be made by the entire council and not a particular members of that community. Okay? But one clause was that, suppose if a bill is to be passed related to any particular community, okay, that bill needs to be passed by 75% or 3/4 members of that particular community. It should not be that particular community. It should be the entire council. Okay, so this was one of the major flaw. Then basically, it is said that 1/3 representation should be given to Muslim. This clause was accepted. But one of the major flaw here was, at least at that time, the population should be 1/3. Then 1/3 representation can be given. Okay? Then, basically, one of the major thing here was, there was a pact being signed. This again reflected what Congress and Muslim League felt. By signing a pact, we are portraying unity. But this was false. Getting the points clear? By this, by signing a pact, they were portraying disunity. While if, basically, if Muslim League and Congress are ready to work with each other, there is no need of any particular pact. There is no need of any particular agreement. If there is an agreement, if there is a pact, what does this simply signify? This simply signifies that both are ready to work with each other on certain terms and conditions. And if these terms and conditions are not fulfilled, they can part away with each other. So rather than projecting unity, disunity is projected in the eyes of the Britishers. And as I've always told you, Britishers are to play the game of divide and rule and break the communal harmony in India. Getting the points clear? So rather than projecting unity, it projected disunity. Getting the points clear? So basically these are the negative impacts of the Muslim League. Oh sorry, Lucknow Pact. Yes, Dipesh, perfect. Yes, Ritu Parna, self-interest was the concern. Yes, my friends, did you understand Home Rule League movement, Lucknow merger and the Lucknow Pact? Please let me know. Yes, guys, please let me know. Did you get the points? Are the things clear? Okay, Kiruba. Okay, guys. I would be posting the PDF soon. Again, a small reminder, a gentle reminder. There would be a test on Sunday as a part of special class on the Unacademy platform. Getting the points clear, guys? And the test would be on ancient India and modern India both. Getting the points clear, my friends? It would be on ancient India and modern India both. So please prepare well in advance for the test. Okay? Okay. Please subscribe to Unacademy and use my code AKOUS. I repeat the code AKOUS. Thanks a lot.